So it was nearly 6 years ago when I was in a similar position like you guys, finishing my last year of college, figuring out what to do in life, and making my next Goa plan. And it was during this time in college that we used to sit and discuss about economy, about business, and also about the environment. We used to wonder what mankind is actually doing to Mother Earth. And at that point, I came to realize that what everything is built and made from materials. These tiny building blocks come from somewhere and eventually go somewhere after their useful life. So that is what I'm going to be talking to you about today. And we believe we've stumbled upon a solution, and that's an idea worth sharing. So I want you to imagine a world where seaweed makes candy wrapper, where algae is used to make aviation jet fuel, where the chairs that you're sitting on is made from agricultural waste. One thing that is common and unique about all these materials is that it comes from a renewable source. These are all bio-based materials. Now, you know, the thirst for economic growth has led mankind into a very linear economy where we extract, manufacture, use, and then we discard it. This system is not only harms the environment, but also we have to realize that the resources that we are mining are all finite. They're all going to stop one day. And now it is with this changing thought, there is a new system that is coming about called the circular economy. This is you might have heard this jargon everywhere, and I'm going to explain that in brief today. This is a regenerative system where we rethink all parts of the entire ecosystem. We think about the materials, we think about the product, we think about the process, and about how it's going to end up after its useful life. Currently, mankind extracts most of its minerals and resources. Like, I want you to think about this. What is the most commonly used base raw material on Earth? This raw material is used to make clothes. It's used to make chairs. It's used to make cars. This raw material is petrochemical-based plastic. Now, plastic came about nearly 6 decades ago, and close to 8.3 billion tons of it has been manufactured. Now, only 9% of this has ever been recycled. Now, think about it a minute. If only 9% has been manufactured, that means 7.5 billion tons of this is lying somewhere in a landfill like this. Now, researchers have been trying to replicate the exact molecular structure of petrochemicals for alternative uses. However, that's where I think we are going wrong. Nature has given us abundant and unique materials. And it's important to study these materials to recognize that each unique material has a unique purpose and can have a unique application. Like, you have seen on social media multiple innovations such as these. But have you ever wondered, why isn't this out there? Why am I not getting this in the shop near me? The primary reason, I believe, is for a circular economy to flourish, multiple stakeholders need to evolve, and they need to evolve together in tandem with each other. And at the center point of this is the consumer. Now, the consumer can demand and can change the way a product is being perceived and manufactured. If a consumer is conscious enough to understand where the product is coming from, how is it made, what is the effect its manufacturing cycle is having on the environment, and where is it going to go after I finish using it, they are going to demand greener and better products. This will push the manufacturers to adopt green bio-based materials. The second most important stakeholder is the government. The government is actually like Godfather. It has the power to direct industries to adopt these materials. It also has the power to mobilize farmers to provide this raw material in large quantities. In fact, the European Union has a directive that all new cars, 85% of their weight should be made from renewable and recyclable material. It is because of this the likes of Audi, BMW, Mercedes-Benz are using agricultural waste, hemp and flax fibers for its carpeting, for its door panels, for its AC vents. You know, plastic is currently a very cost-effective material. The reason is it's manufactured at a large scale. Now, with ample of government support and large-scale production, this is where I believe that bio-based materials can be extremely cost-competitive. And last but not the least, it's important to identify the role of scientific researchers and the community. This community depends on the government grants as well as private funding to be able to develop and innovate new products that can come into your household. Now, the European Union has been the world leader in bio-based materials and bio-based composites. In fact, this year itself, they've used more than 4 lakh tons of bio-based materials. Now, they use agricultural waste, forest waste, as well as agricultural produce like hemp and flax for this construction. Now, just think about it. What kind of a impact it can have on an agrarian society like India, Brazil, or the African nations. That brings me to the point where I talk about the potential impact of bio-based materials. Now, for bio-based materials to grow, it needs to absorb CO2 from the environment. The procedure is not as resource intensive, and once it's at the end of its useful life, it goes back into the environment. So that makes this product essentially carbon neutral. India today produces around 5 million tons of plastic waste every year. 70% of this lands up in landfills. So not only using bio-based materials, are you reducing the pressure on landfills, but also creating a healthier and a safer environment. Most of the resources used today are coming from a finite source. India's largest import bill is that of crude oil. Now, a bio-based economy will ensure that we have multiple sources and can actually transform the Indian economy. And this, one of the greatest beneficiaries of a bio-based economy, is close to the 50% of the population, which relies on agriculture. Now, this percentage was left out during the last industrial revolution and has a chance to participate in this new growing green economy. And it was with these thoughts that we came across a grossly underutilized crop. Now, this crop has been a traditional crop for India, and you'll find it all across India. What I'm talking about is industrial cannabis. And in 2013, a few friends of mine from HRCollege and me started Bombay Hemp Company. So we are essentially India's first company which is focused on research and bringing to market products from industrial hemp. Now, before I let your thoughts run wild, I just want to make a clarification. What I'm talking about is cannabis, yes, but what I'm not talking about is high THC cannabis. So THC is a component that gets you high, that is primarily used to make cannabis or marijuana, weed. But what we grow is hemp. This plant grows to around 10 to 12 feet tall and has extremely useful industrial properties. The hemp plant is used throughout history. During the wartime, it was actually the growth of it was actually propagated because it was an extremely useful resource. Christopher Columbus used ropes and sails made from industrial hemp. In fact, the word canvas comes from the word cannabis. So in India itself, the Ajanta and Ellora caves used a lime-based binder along with hemp for its construction. That's why it's still standing for 1,500 years. Now, why do we believe hemp is such a super crop? Hemp can grow in 90 to 120 days and is one of the largest biomass producers per acre. Excuse me. When you compare this to cotton, for example, 1 acre of hemp creates 4 times more amount of fiber as to cotton. So now the land that's freed up can actually be used to produce food, which is extremely essential for a growing population like ours. Now, coming back to circular economy, where we say all parts of the hemp plant are used, the seeds, the flower, the fiber, and even the stalk. Hemp can make around 5,000 uses, but we at Bombay Hemp Company are focused on few, because that's where we believe hemp can have its maximum potential impact. To start with, we have hemp foods. Hemp foods is not only high and extremely rich in omega-3, 6, and 9, but it is also one of the best sources of plant-based protein. Now, for a vegetarian economy like India, hemp can be an extremely good dietary supplement. Hemp has been part of our Indian tradition for the longest time. Across the Himalayan ranges, right from Uttarakhand to the northeast, you'll find this plant growing in the villages. And the farmers and our villagers use this to make hemp chutney. They use the hemp seeds as a condiment in their vegetables. They also use the fiber to make mats, ropes for their cots, or even jackets. Now, with the advancement in technology, we've been able to refine the process that's required for hemp fabric. For example, the shirt I'm wearing today is made from 100% hemp. To promote this wonderful fabric, we at Bombay Hemp Company have launched our very own clothing line called B-Label. Now, this not only makes dresses and tops for women, but also shirts, t-shirts, and jackets for men. Hemp can and does provide all the essential needs of mankind, which is food, clothing, and shelter. Now, hemp crete, which is essentially hemp shives, which is the inner woody stalk mixed with lime, can be used to make a composite walling material. Now, this is not only extremely lightweight, but also very insulative in nature. To give you a live example, there's Adnams Brewery in United Kingdom. The entire structure is made from hemp-based material. This led to a 40% saving in their electric consumption. Now, the more renowned uses of the cannabis plant is medicine. Now, the extracts and tinctures that are extracted from the leaves and the bud of the plant can actually be used to cure epilepsy, glaucoma, and even help fight cancer. The Indian Ayurvedic texts have properly defined the use of bhang, and in terms of a digestive aid, a sleeping aid, and even for pain relief. Now, we also focused on a few futuristic uses of hemp, like carbon nanosheets. Now, this material can not only be used for water filtration, but also for drug delivery, as well as for supercapacitors. Supercapacitors are used in fast charging and is one of the fastest growing industries currently today. Now, you must be wondering, why isn't this not happening? This is actually happening across the world, be it Europe, America, and of course, China. They are never far behind. They are, in fact, one of the largest cultivators of hemp in the world. And how did they come about this? It was a coordinated effort between the government and the private entities. They have close to 300 global patents on hemp. And the reason they did all this was they wanted to bring the farmers out of poverty. There were certain regions in China where they realized that hemp grows the best. And 3 million farmers have been brought out of poverty just by hemp cultivation. Now, the largest institutional consumer of hemp is, in fact, the Chinese military. They not only use the hemp because of its antimicrobial properties for socks, undergarments, and uniforms, but they have also advanced uses like helmets and bulletproof jackets. Now, it's actually very heartening to know that one of the largest polluting nations is taking good and great steps towards fighting climate change. And that's why I believe that this is one of the solutions that we've adopted. There are plenty of underutilized crops available in India, like banana fiber, pineapple fiber, or even coir, which can make amazing products. So this is the time where every industry is fundamentally changing, be it the transport industry, be it the telecom industry, and it's time even for the material industry to change. So this is an opportunity for everyone, especially the young minds out here, to take this and develop into the future. I just want to end by saying that we all love a good challenge, and I believe that saving the earth is a pretty good one. Thank you.